Belinda presents this unabridged recording of Unleashed, Adam Black, Book 1, written by Karl Hill and read by Martin Donaghy. December 2010. Attack is the best form of defence, assisted by skill, cunning, and a whole lot of fucking luck. Advice given to new recruits of the 22nd Special Air Service Regiment. The weather didn't matter. Not to Adam Black. Snow, hail, fog. Like clockwork, he went for his evening run. Whether it was habit or instinct or even enjoyment, he couldn't be sure. Maybe insanity. But it was ingrained, second nature, down to the harshest training known to man. And so this particular evening was no different from any other. Except the moon. It was a blood moon, unobscured by cloud, surrounded by a million stars. Unlucky, Jennifer predicted as she watched him tying up his trainers, a half smile playing on her lips. Or maybe lucky, Black laughed. Well, I'm out, your lottery ticket might come up. Which would be nice if I ever bought one. A major flaw. Let's be honest, having all that money would be... Let me think. Boring. Who wants to be filthy rich and live a life of shameful decadence and incredible luxury? Surely not you. Jennifer ruffled his hair. Of course not. Heaven forbid. I can barely imagine how awful it would be. Dinner's going to be ready in half an hour. If you're late, you're looking at soggy pasta. Black grinned. Half an hour or soggy pasta. Put that in my headstone, please. I'd rather you put this on your head. She handed him a black woolen mountain hat. It's minus two. Black regarded the hat with scepticism. Seriously? Seriously? I don't want any husband of mine wandering about with frostbitten ears. Embarrassing. For me, that is. What would the neighbours say? He shrugged. It was no use arguing. And put it on. Even with the hat, he cut a compelling figure. Unobtrusively muscular, handsome in a hard-bitten way, rather harsh cheekbones, dark eyes. Tough guys shouldn't need to wear hats like this. Which is precisely why you need to wear one. See you in half an hour, tough guy. Clock's ticking. 2. Black closed the front door behind him. It felt colder than minus two, coming immediately from the warmth. His skin tingled. His lungs felt the bite of the crisp air. A wisp of cloud formed with every breath. He was dressed for the occasion. Close-fitting long-sleeved vest, under a light sweat top with high-vis reflective bands. Cycling shorts under semi-loose track bottoms. Ankle socks. Padded cycling gloves. And the hat, of course. He had tried wearing flat-soled running shoes. If ancient man got around on his bare soles, then why couldn't trendy modern man? Plus, the running magazines raved about the concept. Black had tried them for 6 months, eventually judging the idea as bullshit. Too much stress on the ankles, the calves, his feet sensing every minuscule stone, every edge, every crack. The running magazines were consigned to the bin. Back to the traditional running shoe, all cushioned and springy. He loosened up for a few seconds in the front garden. He avoided stretching. It was overrated, increasing the odds of a pulled muscle. Instead, he jumped gently on the spot, shaking his arms, rotating his neck, swiveling his shoulders, breathing deeply, filling his lungs. He looked up at the night sky, and there it was. A blood moon. A strange, dusky red circle, out of place amongst the stars, like a perfect gemstone, almost alien.
He had seen more blood than he cared to remember, and knew its every shade, every permutation.
This was the colour of old blood, he decided. Blood that leaves a stain. Blood that doesn't wash away. He began his run. His programme changed every week.
To keep rigidly to the same route was a recipe for disaster.
The mind became bored, jaded, affecting the body's performance, until running became worse than a chore, an ordeal. This particular week, it was twice around the village park. From their cottage and back again, it was about a 4.5 mile run. They lived a mile from the village of Eaglesham, located on the outskirts of Glasgow, a village set on the incline of a hill, in the broad shape of a capital A, structured round a common green, an 18th century planned village, filled to the brim with listed buildings, cute cottages, secret lanes. Created that way by the Earl of Eglinton, a rich Scottish aristocrat, apparently an altruist in his day. A cotton mill once stood in the centre, employing upwards of 200 people. The cotton industry died, the mill died with it, reduced to a scattering of stones. The remnants could still be found if a person looked hard enough amongst the trees and bushes and long grass. Black was never a history buff. He had never bothered looking, and never would. The hill going up to the apex of the A was steep, a 0.5 mile of a slog. Going down was a breeze, though the road was treacherous with ice. A twisted ankle was not unknown.
He passed the darkness of woodland, separated from the pavement by a low dry stone wall, until he reached the first street light, and then houses on either side of a two-lane road.
He got to the centre of the village, a row of small, flat-roofed shops, then turned to his right and began the ascent. Here, the road was narrow, the pavement barely wide enough for one person.
On his right shoulder were rows of tall, squeezed, terraced houses with crow-stepped gables, once homes for the mill workers, now overpriced getaway dwellings for rich people with money to burn and time to do it.
On his left, the park, a blot of deep shadow. He slowed a little. The incline was steep. He passed windows and glimpsed people doing what they do, going about their lives, watching TV, cooking dinner, sitting at a table, kids doing homework. Routine stuff. Normal stuff. Halfway up, and he got to the only pub in Eaglesham, the Old Swan. A building of buff red sandstone, Georgian windows, black painted sills.
People were outside in the freezing cold, smoking, chatting, maybe a half dozen. It was noisy inside. A week before Christmas. Party time.
He veered onto the road to avoid any collisions. Someone shouted something. A man's voice. Black's ears were muffled by the hat. What was it? Two words. Fucking clone. Could be. Black ignored him, ran on, and in a few seconds was beyond the pub and back to running past more houses. His route would take him a second time by the Old Swan. By then, whoever had shouted would be finished his smoke and back inside sinking pints. Probably. Black couldn't have been more wrong. 3. 5 hours earlier, 3 p.m. Damien Grant was in a crazy shit mood. And when he was like that, crazy shit tended to happen. His cousin and boyhood friend Tommy Teacup Thompson had seen this played out 100 times before. And though he'd always gone along with it, mostly because he was paid to do so, he still never liked it. Teacup was no stranger to violence himself. Professional boxer, turned enforcer and all-round fixer. but Damien cranked it up to a whole new level. Teacup was watching Damien in the process of snorting his third line of cocaine from a glass-topped side table. They were not the only people in the room.
Sitting in an armchair by a bay window, reading a newspaper, and seemingly oblivious to Damien's rants, was William Blakely,
contracted up from Manchester, dressed impeccably as ever. Powder blue woolen suit, crisp white shirt, white silk tie, shoes polished until they gleamed like mirrors, silver cufflinks. What people didn't know was that he carried a knuckle duster in one inside pocket and a blade tucked in the other, and he wasn't scared to use them. But Damien Grant was in a crazy shit mood, and Teacup didn't know how the hell the day was going to pan out.
I so needed that,
Damien sighed, reclining back on a beige leather chair, legs sprawled in front of him, two pale limbs sticking out like matchsticks from a velvet bathrobe.
I know you disapprove, but guess what? I couldn't care less. Your disapproval gives me no concern. Do you know why?
Why?
Because, old friend, with the crap I have to put up with, no fucking wonder I take sanctuary in hard drugs.
Do you like that word, Teacup? What word?
Sanctuary. That's what this shit gives me. Sheer fucking sanctuary. Sanctuary from the old bastard.
Teacup paused, thoughtful. He had to be careful what he said. Every word was important when Damien was like this. Every word had consequences. On the one hand, the son. On the other, the father. A balancing act. He had to be loyal to both. If word got back he'd spoken ill of Mr. Grant, then he'd have a problem. Consequences.
Your father's not an easy man, Teacup replied, nodding sagely as if in agreement.
He can be difficult, but then he's got a lot on his plate.
A lot on his plate?
Damien glared at him, eyes shining.
What does that even mean? If you're going to open your mouth, at least try to talk some sense.
Damien's voice took an icy tone.
It's about respect, or lack of. I'm not a fucking errand boy. Do this, do that. He snaps his fingers and I come running, scurrying about like his fucking pet dog. Let me explain something to you. Come close.
Damien leaned forward in his chair. Teacup, sitting opposite, bent closer.
It's destroying me,
Damien said, his voice low, barely a whisper.
It's ripping out my fucking soul.
He clutched his hands to his chest in mock drama.
You understand this?
He stared at Teacup. Teacup could only stare back.
When all's said and done, Damien continued softly, I'm quite entitled to my little dalliances.
He raised his head back and burst out laughing, a raw, wild sound.
What do you think of that word, Mr. Blakely?
William Blakely looked up from his newspaper. He spoke in a quiet, measured tone, at odds with his close-cropped haircut and heavy, blunt features. What word was that?
Dalliances, fucking dalliances, awesome, don't you think?
Blakely smiled. Now there speaks an educated man, he said, and resumed reading his newspaper. And Teacup agreed. No expense had been spared in Damien Grant's education. Private schooling, though he had been expelled from two schools, private tuition. He should have done better, but hadn't. His father, Peter Grant, never got the chance to get an education, had clawed his way up from the street, and so had lavished on his son everything money could buy. Only natural. A father looking out for his son, Teacup thought. But Damien had spat it back in his father's face, big time. It was difficult not to hear the bitterness from his voice when he spoke.
That's your third line today, Damien.
Can I make a suggestion?
Watch out! Teacup's about to make a suggestion. This should be something.
Teacup licked his lips. What the hell, he thought. A night in wouldn't do any harm. Silence. Damien regarded him with a long, thoughtful stare. Then he spoke, his tone quiet, almost reasonable. Not a good sign. "A night in? Really? That's your suggestion?" Teacup didn't respond.
He'd said the wrong thing and knew it.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.